Hello, 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 and welcome, everyone. Greetings from a very sunny New York City, aka the Big Apple. Welcome to today's webinar. We'll get started in a couple minutes. There are folks still joining. And while we're waiting for another minute or so, please do say hi in the chat. So that's the chat. Let us know where you are joining us from. Okay, hello Italy, hello Iran and France and Indonesia, or good night. Hello Pakistan, Argentina, Armenia, Indonesia again, Mexico. A lot of folks from Indonesia today. Hello, hello. And Italy again, yep. Ukraine, Malaysia, Philippines, Kazakhstan, Romania, Egypt. Hello, hello, welcome. We'll wait a few more seconds. Servus, Hungary, India, and so forth. Fantastic. Well, welcome. Brazil, Belarus. Excellent. So, welcome, everyone. It is so great to see all of you joining from around the world. My name is Pete Novak, and I'm the country manager for Cambridge Assessment English, and will be your host for today's webinar. We are thrilled to be partnered today with Brandeis University and Ryerson University to deliver this webinar for learners, and I'm particularly thrilled as I'm a Brandeis alum. So this session will explore higher education in the US versus Canada, highlighting the differences in admissions processes between the two countries and provide useful insights into taking your next step in higher education. Let me share a few suggestions for you to enjoy the session. Please close all other programs if you can, just to help your connection. Sometimes there may be a delay. Don't worry if that happens. Please just bear with us. And in any case, this event is live and it's recorded. If you miss something, we will share the link afterwards. During the webinar, you will be able to use the chat box for any comments and the separate Q&A box for any questions for our presenters. So it's the Q&A box for questions to our presenters. The poll function will automatically display for any live polls. If we have a short answer to your question, our moderators will try to type an answer to you straight away and share any useful links they might have. Our presenters will answer as many questions as they can at the end. So don't worry if some of the questions are not answered straight away. But first, it would be great to get an idea of where you're thinking about studying. Is it the US? Is it Canada? Is it perhaps both? Or maybe is it, I don't know, Dwayne Johnson or Ryan Reynolds? I don't know, but maybe it's about study abroad. So are you thinking about studying in the US or Canada or both? Let us know. Okay, a few more answers coming in. Fantastic. Excellent. Okay. So almost half of you are thinking about the US, fifth or quarter or so Canada, and the rest of you are undecided or perhaps both. That's fantastic. You're in the right place. So, by way of introductions, you are likely familiar with Cambridge Assessment English since many of you have already taken or are perhaps preparing for one of our Cambridge English exams. For those who are not familiar with Cambridge Assessment English, we're part of Cambridge University Press and Assessment, a department of the University of Cambridge. For well over 100 years, we have been producing a variety of global standard exams and supporting the communities of primary, secondary, and higher education teachers and learners. Our mission is educational, to help people to learn English and to prove their skills to the world. For us, learning English is more than just exams and grades. It's about having the confidence to communicate and access a lifetime of enriching experiences and opportunities. Our qualifications are based on research and effective teaching and learning. They motivate people of all ages and abilities to learn English and develop practical skills for the real world. Each exam focuses on a level of the Common European Framework, or CFR, helping learners to improve their speaking, writing, reading, and listening skills step by step. Whatever your goals or ambitions, Cambridge English qualifications and exams are a mark of excellence, accepted and trusted by more than 25,000 universities, employers, and government departments all over the world for admissions, for recruitment, graduation, and a whole host of other uses. For this reason, more than 5.5 million people take our qualifications and tests every year. We have a network of about 2,800 centers in 130 countries, as well as more than 50,000 preparation centers helping you learn English and take the exam. The webinar today is not focusing on English proficiency exams, yet participants always ask us about the requirements for studying in the US. I'm happy to say that you can apply across the United States with, in many cases, B2 first, and certainly with C1 advanced and C2 proficiency. That includes the universities presenting today. That's Brandeis University and Ryerson, although at each institution, different programs may have different requirements. So we always recommend for you to take a look at each institution's websites for details. What are the exams? What are the cut scores that they accept? You can visit our global recognition database shown on the slide to see where else your scores are welcome. To share your Cambridge English qualification score, you will need to visit the online results service for candidates on our website, which is displayed on this slide here. You can click on the Send My Result button to securely share your results with your chosen institutions as part of your application. If your chosen institution is not on there, you can send them an invite, contact their admissions department, and contact us at recognition@cambridgeenglish.org. Here's an example screenshot of the next screen you will see after clicking Send My Result button. You can type in your chosen institution into the box, like in this example, Brandeis. And so that brings us to our presenters today. Without further ado, I'm delighted to introduce our wonderful presenters, Cheryl Ramage, Associate Director of International Recruitment at Ryerson University, and Sean Reagan, Associate Director of International at Brandeis University. Over to you, Sean.
Awesome. Thanks, Pete. So as Pete said, my name is Sean, and I'm the Associate Director for International Admissions here at Brandeis University. I'm going to give you kind of a brief overview of just kind of the U.S. university system. There's over 4,000 universities in the United States. That is a lot of universities. But what that means is there's a university for everyone to meet all and any needs. There are research universities. If you are looking at some of these, you might have seen the term Tier 1 or R1 institution. There's about 150 of these in the United States with this designation. These are the top schools conducting research. Brandeis is one of these universities, and we're actually the third smallest in the country. Research schools can be large or small. They can be in rural or urban settings. It's all about the right fit. So you can kind of choose your own learning environment to fit your preferences, because there are over 4,000 schools around. There are liberal arts universities. These can focus on humanities, the arts, music, literature, linguistics. Some of these universities combine both liberal arts and research. Brandeis University is one of those. We are both a liberal arts school, but also a Tier 1 research institution. When it comes to public versus private school, you will hear that a lot when you're looking at US universities. Public schools are usually referring to the state school system. These are typically larger, sometimes in small towns, but not always. Some have many different locations. You're probably familiar with the University of California schools or the State University of New York, Massachusetts state schools. Most of these are comprehensive universities. They'll have all majors and programs, all the varsity sports teams, all the activities on campus. typically larger class sizes until you get into your specific area of study. For private universities, these are a little bit more focused or comprehensive with interdisciplinary courses, which I'll talk about here in a second. These typically have smaller class sizes and a lot more interactive classrooms. At most universities in the US, you'll probably see the term general education requirements, or gen eds as we like to shorten it. We call these 101 courses, typically a general science, a maths, history, English, language, and electives. These are typically your first 2 years at university. In the US, it's almost always 4 years at university. So the first 2 years make up this general education requirement. You'll always almost certainly find these at public or state schools, and at private schools, this can vary depending on the institution. What are majors and minors? You've probably seen those terms as well. These are your areas of focus. Usually you get 2 years to decide on a major. There's nothing wrong with going in undecided. A major is typically your degree or your specialization within a program. To give you an example, you might be in the School of Business or, you know, the business program, working towards a Bachelor of Science in Business Administration, but your major might actually be finance or accounting or marketing. So it's really that specialization that sets the major apart. Next slide, please. Interdisciplinary curriculum is something unique, I think, to US higher education. This is sometimes the main difference between research and liberal arts universities, as well as public and state universities. It's all about flexible courses. You have the options to choose your courses instead of the general education requirements that I just mentioned. Courses will involve real world experiences and topics. A lot of them will have internships and research availability. Some of them will revolve around core values. What does the university represent apart from classroom activity? At Brandeis, we actually look for these things in our applicants. You can see I put here our three core values, and this is something that is very important at Brandeis University and what we look for in students. We're a great example of this interdisciplinary curriculum. We have students who double and triple major. I didn't know triple majoring was a thing until I started working at Brandeis. Courses required in sort of our general education requirements include diversity, equity, inclusion, global engagement, health, wellness, and life skills. You also might see cross-listing courses where one course can count towards many different requirements within those first 2 years. But primarily it's all about flexibility with interdisciplinary coursework. When it comes to the US application process, there's the common application versus the individual university application. Most US schools are on the common application. This allows you to choose your top schools to apply. I believe it's limited to 20 universities right now. Many schools will offer a more simple individual app as well. So just make sure to check which schools use the Common App or which schools prefer their individual application. So what do you need? What do you need to apply to the US universities? Transcripts first and foremost. That means all secondary school, whether it's 3 or 4 years, depending on the school system that you're in, make sure to check the university requirements. Translations, they're not always required. Sometimes they can be certified and stamped by your school or your school counselor. Some schools can do their own translation, in their office. WES or ECE reports, these are third-party evaluations. These can be helpful for applying for possibly maybe a master's degree, or if you have multiple secondary schools, or maybe you've switched schools at times and your trajectory was a little bit more complicated than most. English proficiency, also make sure to check what's accepted. When it comes to testing, the SAT and ACT, many schools now in the US are test optional, are test flexible. So again, make sure to check each school's requirement. And of course, counselor and teacher letters recommendation are always typically required, whether through the Common App or the individual university app. When it comes to more selective universities, such as Brandeis University, essays and extracurriculars are very important in the application process. I love the essay section of the application. This is the one section of the app where you get to truly be yourself and tell us all about you. In your essay, you don't have to tell us about your activities or your academic achievements. We can see that already. We can see your transcripts and your grades. Tell us something about you we can't see in the rest of the application. It doesn't always have to be something extraordinary. It can be creative. It can be funny. Just be yourself. We see so many applications that just kind of recite the extracurriculars, you know, talk about grades and achievements, but they end up kind of hurting their applications, or they become a little flat or boring. When it does come to the extracurricular activities, we prefer quality over quantity. It's not always about how long or how much you write. We see thousands of applications each year. We can tell when students are being genuine. We're trained to do that. We're very good at spotting this. Some questions to kind of think about when you're kind of brainstorming your ideas to put on your activities. How engaged are you outside of the classroom? What interests do you have? Are you taking initiatives? Think about university values. I talked about those three Brandeis core values. Do those reflect your own values? Do you see yourself getting involved on campus, or do you just plan on studying, graduate, leaving, you know, getting a career? That's fine, but not all schools are looking for that. If you're working full-time, part-time, if you have family responsibilities, let us know. Schools will look at the resources you have and the time that you allot that. We understand you might not have time for extracurriculars, so let us know. We take that into consideration, and it does not have any negative impact on the review or hurt your application in any way. Some of my top tips that I like to share with students when they're applying to the US. First one's easy, be honest. When it comes to extracurriculars, do the math. Make sure the times add up on the extracurricular activities. We do check that. Sometimes the math, it doesn't make sense, and it makes us think you're just writing anything to fill the space in the section. Do not write "see resume." We won't see resume. Take the time to put that into your extracurriculars, or make sure it's covered elsewhere in the teacher or counselor letter recommendation or in your essay. Speaking of essays, when it comes to supplemental essays, do your research. Why this university? For example, why Brandeis University? Is it the specific courses? Is it the interdisciplinary curriculum? Do you plan on studying one of our 13 different foreign languages or triple majoring? Maybe you want to be in the city of Boston, which is in, you know, the picture here of downtown Boston. Mainly just show your interest in the university. The next, what is the cookie cutter essay, as I like to call it? This is usually the answer to the question above, why this university? We can tell when an essay has been copied and pasted and the university name has changed. If you do this, please triple check that you change the name out. We do every year read many apps that forget to switch the name on the essays. And it typically doesn't look very good. It kind of shows a little bit of lack of effort, like you rushed the application, especially if you correct it later on in the essay. Many times I'll see, I'm very interested in Columbia University, and then the next sentence will be like, I look forward to studying at Brandeis University. So make sure to always look out for that. Obviously, punctuation, consistency is important, especially in the extracurricular sections. Optional pieces of the application. If you ever hear a counselor or an admission staff say, I highly recommend, or I encourage you to do something, this is our way of saying you probably should do it, especially at selective universities and applying for financial aid. Some of these things that include optional interviews are always great if they're available, especially if you're applying for financial aid. This is a great way for us to get to know you outside of what we read, and also for you to get to know a little bit more about the university, because sometimes these are conducted by ourselves as the admission staff or current students, including international students. So it's a great way to kind of interact with a current member of our community. And finally, financial aid and scholarships. Most universities will offer one, or if not both. Merit scholarships, many schools will have automatic consideration for merit. Some might have specific course scholarships. You know, they might be in the sciences, engineering, they might be art specific. Brandeis has the Leonard Bernstein Fellowship, specifically for students interested in the orchestra. Right now it's specifically for violinists. So we have a great scholarship for that. There are typically GPA requirements. You can check the university sites for minimum requirements. Many will have a minimum maybe 3 to 3.5 GPA or equivalent, and we can do all of that calculation in our office. They can range from a few thousand dollars up to full scholarships and awards. Make sure to do your research and contact the university for those. When it comes to financial aid, unfortunately, international students are not eligible for the same federal aid or loans as domestic students are. However, we do offer need-based financial aid. And that kind of breaks down into need-aware versus need-blind. And it's okay to ask universities if you're need-aware or need-blind. We are okay with telling students that. Both of these meet full demonstrated need based off calculations. Need-aware means we need all of the finances before universities make a decision. Universities like Brandeis, we have budgets, we have limited seating. We can only admit so many students, and it does get quite competitive. Need-blind means that universities will admit you before knowing the costs, before the finances come in. This is also very competitive. Again, both of these typically are not full scholarships. They just meet you at your full demonstrated need. And all this is based off of estimated financial contribution. And that comes from the CSS profile or the ISFAA. Go ahead and ask your universities. Almost all universities can't provide CSS profile waivers, but some can accept the ISFAA, which is a free form that you can fill out to universities. So that was just kind of a really quick overview of kind of the US higher education system, a little bit about Brandeis University in there. Feel free to drop questions in the Q&A, but now I'd like to turn it over to my colleague, Cheryl, who will talk about the Canada. Oh, Cheryl, I think you're muted. There we go.
Thanks, Sean. Thanks for everyone for tuning in to this webinar today and learning about your options in both the US and Canada. So just to introduce myself quickly again, so my name is Cheryl Ramage. I'm an associate director of international recruitment at Ryerson University. We're located in the heart of downtown Toronto, and we really are Canada's urban university. So to take a bit of a step back, just to provide you with a high-level overview of Canada, if you don't know already. So one of the largest countries in the world, we have just over 36 million people part of our population. We are a very multicultural country. So, you know, an interesting stat that I like to share is one in four Canadians were actually born outside of Canada. So we have 10 different provinces and three territories. Again, being a very multicultural country, there's over 200 different languages spoken, and our two official languages are English and French. So what a lot of potential students do ask me about, we were just chatting about it before we started this this webinar, is what is the weather like? Is it really cold? So we do have four seasons, so fall, winter, summer, and spring. You know, our summers are very warm. Our winters can be cool too. But I will say that the majority of our population, almost 90% of our population, lives very close to the Canada-US border. So our population does live in the warmest part of the country. So why should you, next slide, please. Great. So why should you choose Canada? So we have the highest rate of adult population with a post-secondary education among OECD countries. We rank consistently in high quality education in all provinces and territories. And I'll get into that in a little bit, how our education system is set up. We have strong economic, political, and educational institutions, and we do have a competitive cost of living compared with other top ranking destinations. So next slide, please. So other reasons why you might want to consider studying in Canada. So we rank third for quality of education, life, and job prospects for international students. So international students do have the opportunity to get a post-graduation work permit by the time they're completed their studies. And I did share a link in the chat to the Canadian government's website so you can learn a little bit more about that. So over 15,000 quality assured undergraduate and graduate programs at more than 100 universities. And 38% Canadian colleges and universities perform an estimated 38% of all research and development in Canada. So getting more particularly, again, into post-secondary institutions. Next slide, please. So there's nearly 100 publicly funded universities that are regulated provincially. So we don't really have any private post-secondary institutions. The majority of our universities and colleges are funded by the university. So essentially what that means is no matter what post-secondary institution you choose to go to, if you're thinking of Canada, you are getting high quality education that is recognized around the world. It's really just up to you to do your research, and it's great that you're at a webinar like this, to find out what is the best fit institution for you. So, you know, are you looking, and don't only think about the academics, what do you want your lifestyle to be? You know, do you want to, you know, live more in a small town? Do you want to live maybe in an urban center where perhaps the universities has lots of different connections to industries, where you can find somewhere to do an internship or a co-op? Extracurricular activities might be really important to you, or even sports. So do some research and figure out everything in addition to academics that that post-secondary institution is offering to you. One thing that I want to highlight here is the term colleges versus universities in Canada. So these terms are not interchangeable. They're two different things. So a university in Canada is where you are offered four-year undergraduate degrees and then graduate and PhD programs. A college is something a little bit different in Canada. So generally at college, you can get 2 or 3 year advanced diplomas. Some colleges will offer you undergraduate degrees as well, but they're a little bit more vocational based. It's still high quality education. You're just focusing on different things. So to get into the application process, so how do you apply to university? So generally, applications are open 1 year in advance of the term that you are looking to apply to. So for example, if you are looking, generally universities intakes are going to be in the winter or January or fall, which is the month of September. So if you're interested in September 2023, for example, you would start your application in September 2022. So application deadlines are later than the UK and the US. So again, it's really important that you're checking each institution's websites. And an academic year is generally 2 terms. So if you're interested in the September term, you're studying from September until December, and then there's a mid-year break. And then you are going to be studying again from January up until the end of April. So next slide, please. So a little bit more about the application. So how you apply. So all of our applications are done online, and I'll use Ryerson just as an example. So Ryerson is one of 21 universities in the province of Ontario, and all of these universities, they use a centralized online application system. It's called the Ontario Universities Application System. And that's where you start your application. You have the opportunity to apply up to 3 different universities, and that's where you're going to start your application process. Some universities, including Ryerson, we do have our own online application specifically for international students. So if you know that you want to apply only to Ryerson or a university, I would recommend you to apply directly on their website. So requirements. So what are needed if you're applying to a Canadian post-secondary institution? So again, it's really important to check their website, but generally I'm going to speak high level to it. So if you're applying to a Canadian university, what we place the most amount of importance on is your academic achievements. So there aren't any essays included in your application. in terms of a lot of questions students have, you know, do you require SATs, ACTs? We don't. If you have taken those tests, we definitely want to see the result because it'll strengthen your application, but that is not a requirement. So we're looking for official transcripts from your high school and then maybe any post-secondary study that you have done after that. Of course, proof of English language proficiency. Details on that were shared at the beginning of this presentation. And then some programs may have some supplemental requirements or non-academic requirements. So again, just emphasizing that the majority of Canadian institutions, we're purely looking at your academic achievement. And then some programs might have like a program, let's say like architecture or interior design, or maybe something like journalism might have some non-academic requirements. So that might be a portfolio of your creative work. It could be a personal statement. It could be an in-person or a virtual audition. So again, really important for you to do your research ahead of time. In terms of the transcripts that you're going to be submitting, so if they are in a language other than English or French, we do require you to submit an official translation. So next slide, please. So in terms of fees and finances, so Canadian institutions do have affordable tuition fees relative to other G8 countries. There are merit-based awards and special scholarships available to international students. So just to highlight some of the scholarships available to international students at Ryerson, for example, we have the President's Entrance Scholarship. And the point that I want to highlight here is this is where your extracurricular activities are going to come into play. So the President's Entrance Scholarship, for example, that's a total value of 40,000 Canadian dollars that's awarded throughout your 4 years at the university. The way that you qualify to apply for this scholarship is you have excellent academic achievement in your final year of high school. So something equivalent to an A+ or, you know, a 90% out of 100. You also need to submit 2 letters of support. So maybe from a guidance counselor, from a teacher. And then there's also a piece of creative writing that you have to submit. We also have the International Secondary School Merit Scholarship, specifically for international students. That's a one-time value of 5,000 Canadian dollars. So again, you have to have excellent academic achievement. So an overall average in your last year of high school of 85% or an A or higher. And you have to write a personal statement that speaks to your leadership skills. So we want to see that you've made a positive impact in the world. You know, you've really changed someone's life for the better. So again, these are where all of the extracurriculars will come into play. We don't consider them when you're getting admitted to the university, but it's important when you're applying for a scholarship. So if you are an international student in Canada, you do have the opportunity to work part-time hours while you're studying full-time. So that's 20 hours per week during a break when you're not studying, like a summer break. You can work up to full-time hours, which is 40 hours a week. And then woven right into your degree, if this is something that you choose to do, you have the potential perhaps to do a co-op. So that's where you can get at Ryerson, for example. So it's up to 16 months of paid work experience. So you are expanding, you're building your resume, you're expanding your network to maybe even have that job offer even before that you graduate. And most Canadian universities are going to have some sort of cooperative education program as well. I would also recommend that you go to the Canadian government website or scholarships.gc.ca, and that's going to give you an idea of all of the scholarships that are awarded to international students, specifically by the Canadian government, and how you might apply. There's also opportunity for transfer credits. So if you have already completed some post-secondary education, you could be assessed for a transfer credit after you are awarded admission to the program. So next slide, please. So if you are getting a Canadian post-secondary degree, it's a flexible degree, again, with employment opportunities on and off campus. So that's something I just highlighted as well. I also want to say that our degrees are very customizable. So you do have the opportunity to perhaps do a double major. Most universities are going to provide you with the opportunity to do a minor. So that's a secondary area of education. So I'll use myself as an example here. So I graduated from Ryerson. I did a major in humanities and social sciences called Arts Contemporary Studies, but I also wanted a background in business. Because through our business school, I did a minor in marketing. Next slide, please. So just a few resources that I'd like to leave you with to do research on perhaps post-secondary opportunities in Canada. So there's the Universities Canada website, Global Affairs Canada, and also EduCanada as well. And I will pass it back to our host.
Thank you, Cheryl. Thank you, Sean, for this presentation. Let's now take some questions. So if you have any questions, please post it in the Q&A section. Okay, and let's start with a question from Marilia. Considering international students, what could help or contribute for them to be accepted? And that should be for both of our presenters.
Sure, I can answer that first in terms of for Ryerson and most Canadian institutions. So again, the majority of Canadian institutions are really looking in order to be admitted to the program. It's your academic achievement. So we want to see that you've have strong results in your last year of high school. The other thing that you want to be mindful of is you have the right subject prerequisites to qualify for the program that you are applying to. So for example, if you're applying to humanities and social science-based programs, make sure you have an English literature course. But if you're applying to something like engineering, for example, you want to make sure that you have courses like math, physics, and chemistry. And then of course that you meet the English language requirements for the program that you're applying to.
Yep. It's very similar in the US. First and foremost, it's the academics. We want to make sure that, you're going to succeed at the university. After that, if you're applying to more selective universities, ones that might not offer as many seats or is very competitive with financial aid, then it comes down to all of the things that I mentioned during the presentation, such as the extracurricular activities. Demonstrated interest is important, the extra essays, optional interviews, supplemental essays, the more you can provide us, the more helps us make a decision. So really, it's kind of that holistic approach is what we like to call it, that can help students get accepted.
Great. And Cheryl, you've touched on this for Canada in terms of work and study. Sean, can you touch on that for the US, a variety of different types of institutions? What are the options for working and studying for an international student?
Sure. So as long as you're a full-time international student, taking the right course load under what we call the F1 or student visa, you can actually work part-time during the semesters up to 20 hours per week. In the summers, you can work up to 40 hours if you're not taking any classes. During usually your third and fourth year, there's something called CPT, where you can work outside of campus, approved through the program or with a professor or through the university. And then afterwards is what's called OPT, where you can extend your student visa to work legally in the US anywhere from 1 to 3 years, depending on the program. Usually if it's STEM field, you can extend that up to 3 years. If it's non-STEM, it's usually 1 or 2 years.
Excellent. And we have a question here from Milena. Do you have any advice on how to manage your time with school, work, and social life?
Yeah, so that's a great question. And it's pretty relevant for Brandeis. Students at Brandeis University are extremely involved. I don't know how they balance their time. It comes down to the support systems. Many universities offers campus support in a variety of different ways. So luckily, with the US system being 4 years, that first year is really a way for you to kind of get to know your preferences, get to make friends, get to be involved, and just kind of figure out what university life is for you. So really that first year is kind of an exploration on how to balance all of that. And really take advantage of the support systems on campus. All US universities will have an international student support office. We have counseling support offices. We have student run offices. And so the universities are well equipped because we do understand that going to university can be a little intimidating, especially when you want to be extremely involved. And many universities are equipped to handle this. Brandeis, we have 20% international students. So we do have quite an extensive support system on campus for students.
Yeah, and I can speak to a little bit about that, at least for Ryerson. So what I would say is, it can definitely be a challenge transitioning from, high school to university, from a different country to another. Often universities or post-secondary institutions, there might be an opportunity for you to have a mentor. So for example, at Ryerson, there's something we call the Tribe Mentorship Program. So that's where you would be paired with an upper year student, maybe in the third or fourth year of their undergraduate degree. And it's either in the same program as you or the same faculty. And it's really up to that individual, again, to help you with the transition from high school to university, give you some strategies for success. It could come down to even, time management skills, connect you with certain resources in the university. So international student support, student learning support. Maybe you have a really challenging, math or science class. There's English language support as well. And they would even recommend some clubs that you could join. So that's really important as well. So, you definitely want to feel like you're a part of the community. So student clubs, are a really important way, to make friends and feel involved. Because of course, your post-secondary career isn't all about what you're learning in the classroom. It applies to your personal life as well.
Fantastic. And then we have a good number of questions about proficiency. I assume in many cases, this refers to English proficiency. So let me just touch on that briefly. In Canada, in general, there is a requirement for English proficiency exams. There are usually a variety of exams that are accepted. Cambridge English is widely accepted, but please check each institution's website for which exams and what minimums they require. For the US, it's a little bit more complex. Almost all the institutions require English proficiency. For community colleges, it might be a placement test that is mandatory if you're an international student. And some institutions can waive it or have a recommended, which is highly recommended, English proficiency suggestion. In any case, please take a look at the institution's website. Especially, I would say in the US, there's certainly more changes with testing, including with SATs and ACTs. So take a look by the time you're looking to apply to make sure that you have the latest. In terms of proficiency levels, consider C2 is certainly accepted everywhere. Generally, C1 is accepted everywhere as well in terms of CFR. And then certain institutions might welcome you with a B2, and community colleges have English proficiency ESL programs, support programs. So you might be able to join a community college in the US with a B1 as well. And I believe Canada has these English support and pathway programs as well. So that's just a brief overview of the English requirements. Cheryl or Sean, did I miss anything around that high level, or do you have anything to add here? I'll take that as we covered that.
Yep, all covered. Thanks, Pete.
So there's some great questions. Again, please post any of your questions in the Q&A, not in the chat. So post it in the Q&A. We have a follow-up question on sort of the work options. So how about the work opportunities after graduation? Can you guys speak to the US and to Canada for options after graduation?
Sure. So after graduation, as I mentioned, there's that OPT program, which allows you to stay and work on your student visa for 1 to 3 years. After that, it's really working with, you know, the Career Center, you know, at the university you're with. But then it's all about getting the work visa, and that has to be supplied by the employer. And those are what's called the H visas or H1 to H4 visas. And those are provided by companies. The universities can provide support in helping you get, you know, interviews, getting you talking to companies and work opportunities, but they can't sponsor a work visa. So that comes afterwards with the company.
So it is similar in Canada. So we have something called the postgraduate work program. And that essentially is once you are completed your studies, and this is why it's a good idea to be doing, you know, a co-op or an internship so you can start building these connections. You know, if you do receive a job offer by a company, you can apply for a postgraduate work permit. I think, and it's a really good idea to read the Canadian government website really thoroughly for all details on that. And I think that link has been posted in the chat a few times, and I'll post it again. But yeah, main message is, yes, there is opportunity.
Okay, and just some follow-up questions around scholarships. So what is generally included in scholarships and what are the types of scholarships? We also have a question from Monica about government scholarships.
So in the US, scholarships can range from anything, a few thousand dollars all the way up to full awards. Each university is completely different. There's also need-based financial aid available. There are scholarships for international students, not just domestic. The only difference is that international students are not eligible for the federal financial aid. So there's no government awards or funding for international students, but it will really depend on the university, the type of university. So you just need to kind of do your research. Some are automatically considered, so you don't need to provide a separate application. Some schools do have separate applications for specific scholarships. So you really need to check with each university.
So again, so that is similar for Canadian post-secondary institutions. So most universities in Canada do have entrance scholarships specifically for international students, and you would have to, and the awards, the range, it does depend. So again, would recommend that you go directly to each university's websites to determine if you would qualify. Generally, they are awarding those entrance scholarships to students that have strong academic achievement, and then also looking at extracurricular activities as well, and perhaps some reference letters from guidance counselors or teachers. And then once you become an actual student enrolled at a Canadian university, generally you would most likely qualify for maybe a faculty-wide award or a leadership-wide award. So there's lots of opportunity as well once you are actually enrolled at a university.
And these scholarships are available for international students, not just domestic students?
That's correct.
Fantastic. Now, several of you are asking about specific industries and majors. Can we talk briefly about the medical side? How does it work in US and Canada? If you're interested in medicine to become a doctor, for example, or some related field, can you speak to that, please?
So the US, it is a little bit more complicated. Typically, you have to start from the beginning. It's very difficult to transfer because of the different types of qualifications between different countries and the regulations that it's pretty difficult to transfer depending on where you are in your studies when it's come to medicine. If you are starting off fresh into medicine in the US, you basically take 4 years at a bachelor's degree. It's called pre-medicine or pre-med track. It's not necessarily a bachelor's degree in medicine. It could be a bachelor's in biology, biotechnology, chemistry. It's really up to you. You just will be on the pre-med track for the 4 years, and you'll get the advising to help you take the exams and have the support to go on into medical school. And that is your graduate school. That is when you will really start to take all of your medical classes. After that, there's residency requirements. There's an additional specializations. Sometimes the full total amount of years can range anywhere between 10 and 13 years to become a doctor in the US. So it is quite long, and it can be quite complicated. It's best to start fresh from the beginning with that pre-med track. There's typically not any special requirements because you're still doing the same four-year degree as any other students in any other program. You would just kind of get that advising system after year two to kind of prepare you to take the exams and to go on into medical school or graduate medical school.
So again, this is it's quite similar in Canada. So your first step is getting an undergraduate degree that would be considered a pre-med. So really giving you a strong foundation to do well in medical school. So, you know, those would be programs maybe like, you know, life sciences, biology, you know, biomedical physics. And then you would be applying to a medical school, which is essentially like graduate school. You would have to research, you know, universities that have medical schools in Canada. But generally the way that you would get admission or qualify to apply to a medical school is having, you know, excellent academic achievement, because of course it's competitive. There is the MCAT test that you have to take as well. And everything else is similar to the US.
Great. And I have a question about the overall experience studying at a university in US versus Canada. What would you say if someone is considering studying abroad, right? And considering a variety of countries, what really makes the US experience and what really makes the Canadian experience unique from your perspective?
I think it's probably very similar to both, but I the diversity, you know, both the US and Canada, you know, are extremely diverse. And I think having international students, when they come, they don't realize how diverse it's actually going to be when they get on campus and how many students they're going to meet from around the world, you know, in a learning environment. And I also just think the support systems of universities that are provided to international students, I think all universities are equipped to handle it. And it's great when students can come here and we welcome them and they feel at home once they arrive and you know, eventually just want to hopefully stay.
Yeah, that's great. You know, it's similar. And just to add that, again, the diversity piece is, you know, is huge. You know, when you come to a Canadian university, you know, you are going to be engaging in really, you know, interesting conversation in the classroom. You're going to be hearing a diversity of world perspectives that will probably even shape and challenge your own going forward, just really further preparing you to become a global citizen. And it fosters lots of creative ideas and innovation as well.
And we have a question here just to confirm, at what age should students consider applying for college? And just to expand on that, are there other moments in life or other pathways to be able to study at a higher education institution in the US or Canada?
I think you have to be at least 16 for visa-wise in the US, but typically students apply, you know, right after secondary school, or maybe they take a gap year or two. So it's anywhere between that 17, 19, but we definitely have students that apply as non-traditional students. Again, with over 4,000 schools, there's a university for everyone. And I think that's kind of leads me to different pathways for students to come in. There's all different kinds of ways to get into the education system, whether it's applying direct or through maybe a summer program, a summer language immersion program, through a pathway program, community college, which are usually 2 years, completing general education requirements and then transferring to a four-year U.S. university. There's many different options, but it's all there to kind of cater to your preferences and needs.
So in Canada, it is 18 years of age. You can study, you can apply before that, but you would need to have a guardian, and that would be attached to your study permit to qualify to apply for a study permit.
And are there opportunities for students to consider studying in Canada that's beyond just the direct admissions? Perhaps either study abroad as an exchange student or transfer student? How would those work?
So I would say generally there are, you know, there are opportunities maybe to be studying English. So there's lots of, you know, there's lots of English schools that where students can come and maybe do a short-term summer program as well.
Fantastic. I think that covers most of the questions here. There are questions specifically around a variety of industries and specific institution groups. I would just suggest to visit the institution websites for specific details, which institution offers specific degrees you're looking for, and so forth. And with that, I believe we have covered the great questions we have seen. So a big thank you to our two presenters, Sean and Cheryl, for this informative presentation. Thanks also to our audience for joining us today for some great questions. Sorry that we couldn't get to all of them, but I think hopefully that you have a idea of where to start your research. And feel free to contact the institutions, right, that have presented today. You see the email addresses here. We hope that you found the overall presentation helpful, and we would certainly appreciate your feedback on the survey after this session, and look for the follow-up with an email with the recording. In terms of our next webinar, please do join us on Wednesday, March 16th at 16 p.m. GMT, where we will be joined by Shorelight to explain about our exciting new scholarship offer, how Cambridge English qualification holders can benefit from scholarships and discounts to top-ranked Shorelight universities, which are public and private universities in the U.S. So with that, we wish you all the best in your academic journeys, wherever that may take you. Till next time, stay safe and goodbye, everyone. Thank you.
Thank you.